Whether or not we served in uniform, are veterans of a war in which freedom and free government are at stake. Our victory, won at staggering cost, will not be consolidated until we and our children and grandchildren know the manifold ways in which freedom is still under attack, and we are equipped mentally, spiritually, and physically to defeat every threat. Such fullness of knowledge is the direct function of education. Most of us work hard to provide our homes with every possible comfort for our children. We safeguard their health. We strive to set before them good examples of moral living, of manners and deportment. Possibly we even pamper them. Yet complacently, even carelessly, we commit our children to schools of which we know but little. We cannot meet the complexities of modern life with outmoded school systems. We must keep our educational standards abreast of the swift-moving times in which we live, if we hope to preserve our national heritage and our American way of life. The American way. Is it a city or a farm?
It's the Tigers.
It's the Yanks.
It's our home.
And my job.
The free press.
Our Father, which art in heaven. Freedom. What does it mean?
Why, freedom is a lot of things. It's individual opportunity. The right of private ownership.
It's more than that. It's freedom of speech. People can live without fear. A man has the right to work where he wants to, with incentive.
Freedom is the road to achievement. It permits the discovery of science. The American way eliminates master and slave. And we, who have no master, better serve the world.
But this was to be a meeting on schools. I came here to discuss my child, and all you talk about is rights and heritage and
things. You're all talking too fast. Too fancy for me. I've got a field to plow. I can see right now where we're not going to solve any rural school problems with this meeting.
Wait a minute there, Mr. Farmer. This is a strange meeting, isn't it? You think you're here and then you're not. A thing like this could never really happen. And still, it's happening all around us. For this isn't a meeting of any group or any group of groups. It's a meeting of minds. Yours and mine and everyone's. Who am I? Why, I'm the people. And who are you? Well, we picked a farmer to represent all farmers. And a housewife who is a mother, hoping she'll speak for all mothers. There's a businessman and a foreign-born American. And there's a doctor in the house. It's an open meeting, open to all. And we all have a reason for being here, our schools. We fought a war against the isms of foreign political groups, and we're here to win the peace in our schools.
There's no room in our schools for anything that attacks democracy.
Foreign isms are like germs. They can't attack a healthy body.
For years, I dreamed of coming to America. I hoped my children could be raised without fear and oppression. When you see how they live over there, then you know maybe even better than a native-born American.
Now, wait a minute.
Do you mean to tell me that a foreign book...
No. Take it easy.
I'm descended from a signer of the Declaration of Independence.
My grandfather fought for...
That's very interesting. Now, tell me, how did you all vote on increased school funds?
Well, my business has been off. My taxes are high. I voted against it.
I had a luncheon appointment, and it completely slipped my mind.
Well, I don't think my excuse is even as good as that.
Then it is true. Freedom is subject to attack from the inside as well as out. It's hard to get people to sense danger, just as it's hard to get people out to vote. We couldn't even fill the sixth chair at this meeting.
Why should I come? I don't have any children. It's not my problem.
Who was that?
That was the voice of complacency. Or I should say, half of the population of the United States.
He's the guy who doesn't have children, or maybe they're not in school now. It's not his problem. He doesn't have time. But we're leaving that chair open in hopes that he'll change his mind and join us. Join you and the millions of others who do care, who are interested in perpetuating our free democracy.
How serious is this problem?
It's this serious.
Let me tell you. Why, I remember like it was yesterday. He was like a baby then. I guess to me, he always will be. Leaving him on his own for the first time, I was a little afraid. And still, I was happy. There were things I couldn't teach my son. Things he'd have to learn from others, like working and living in a world with other people, respecting their rights and assuming the responsibility of regular duties. Some want their children to be scholars, but what I wanted most was that he grow up to be a good citizen.
Most people do feel that way.
I know. I wanted my boy to like school, to feel at home, to have a pleasant place to go to. But...
You sound disappointed.
That first day is always hard.
Any day in that room would be hard. Why, they haven't done a thing to that school since I was a girl. The desks, the lights.
It's hard on the kids, and it's hard on the teacher, too. Crowded schools exist everywhere. And there's a teacher shortage. Or haven't you heard?
Well, they gave my boy half a seat. And ever since, I've had the feeling that he's only had half the chance that's rightfully his.
And there's the matter of safety, too. Fear of injury and fear of ill health.
You're right. A crowded schoolroom is the breeding ground for communicable disease.
But the biggest loss is in education. Teachers cannot effectively instruct classes that number as high as 40 pupils. You know how difficult it can be to manage one child. Then consider, what would you do with 40?
What's the reason behind this crowded condition?
There are many reasons. But it all comes under one heading, the increase in population. Our birth rate is up, and our school facilities have lagged behind.
Young couples have been setting up entirely new communities where there's only been rural schools.
Cities are certainly crowded beyond capacity.
And for children, overcrowding means unsupervised play, discontent, and the kind of insecurity that leads to crime and delinquency. Yes, there are many causes for crowded schools and many bad results. Your child must sit and wait his turn. Now, that's all right as a lesson in patience and courtesy, but children cannot wait to grow up. They need their opportunity today, just as they need their food today, and they need their education today. Deny them of it now, and they miss it forever. And that's a handicap when they take on their obligations as citizens.
That's what I meant. I feel that my child has only half a chance, and he's growing right before my eyes.
He's quite a grown young man.
Yes, he's in high school now. But I worry so about him. Since the beginning, he's felt strange about school. He's never really felt at home there. If they had a few things, a few touches to make a youngster feel welcome and at home. My husband's plant is modern. It's well lighted, it's cheerful. And my kitchen, it's pleasant and efficient. I have a place for everything. Why can't our boy have at least some of the advantages in school that he has at home?
He should have. Your boy needs the security that is built by a happy school association. It's protection against unhappiness and dissatisfaction, two evils that ruin countless lives.
Tell me, does he take any special interest in his education? Does he intend going on?
I don't think so. We'll consider ourselves lucky if we can even get him to finish high school.
Have you spoken to his teacher lately? She's interested and can help.
I hadn't thought of that.
He's going to need an education to make a living.
Well, that's right. My boy increased our crop yield almost 40% with the scientific farming methods he brought back from school. Yeah, it sure pays off.
It's gilt edge. A year in school pays off 3-1 in future dollar earnings.
Yet one-third of our national school population drops out before finishing high school because of conditions provoked by the shortage of facilities and teachers.
That means that one out of every three is denied his right to a chance?
That's correct. These are only the lucky ones. The children who live in alert, awakened communities, where teachers and parents join hands in a common bond of partnership. And these are the unhappy leftovers. Some become uncooperative. Others are called maladjusted. Still others we pass off simply as being poor students. They are victims of school shortages, replacement equipment, and the national emergency for 1 million new teachers in the next 10 years. Yes, they must suffer for our crime.
I wouldn't want that to happen to my child.
It happened to mine.
And no one can guarantee that it won't happen to yours, except you. Here are the symbols of complacency. Is your home that outmoded? Would you go to an office or a club full of gloom? Can you work without tools or cook with broken utensils? Or what's more important, would you willingly go to a place day after day that depressed you? That made you feel unwelcome because there wasn't room for you?
Certainly not.
No!
No!
Then we shouldn't expect our children to either. For there's a better way. A way to plan our children's future. A progressive, sensible way. For this is their one invitation to learning. And it must be inviting.
That's quite a layout.
Yes, it is. America's future is in the test tubes of our school laboratories. Laboratories functionally designed for the students' use. Sometimes all a school needs is a little facelifting. Here's the old. And here is the new miracle of modern posture seating and lighting. Here's a junior high school foods room before remodeling. And here's the same classroom transformed so that daughter can practice the latest techniques in preparation of nutritious, economical meals. And the old sewing room at the same school.
Those surroundings aren't very inviting.
It wasn't. But it provided the structural walls in which to fit the modern tools for instruction.
Look at that lighting and those broad working surfaces.
Those are tools for learning and tools for teaching, too. It makes it possible for our teachers to do the best job, to do the job they're trained for. What's more important, it's pleasant for the children. The girls like to work here, and what they like to do, they do well. Yes, given the facilities and the model professional educator, our children can be equipped with the knowledge and experience of daily life. Sure, the 3 R's are important, very important, and always will be. But there's more to education than that. There's fair play. And preparing the child to make a good home. To dress better on less money. And develop a sense of good taste and pride. To hold a better job. And there's culture. Directed toward no more practical purpose than the simple joy of living. With the modern tools of education, school can become an exciting adventure. A trip to far-flung corners of the earth. An exhilarating, interesting experience. With the processes of learning speeded up to meet the many complexities of modern life. Our courses of study must awaken the natural curiosity of youth. For the future of our national welfare depends upon the product of today's classroom. And that's our future.
You're right. It is. I see what you mean now. I have been complacent. But you see, not having any kids, I naturally didn't give schools too much thought. Well, anyway, you asked me to come, so I...
No apologies necessary. You count for half the people in the United States.
My name is Fred Smith.
How do you do?
Welcome.
And I'm Doc Colby.
Heaver's my name.
Heaver's? Glad to know you. Well, I guess I am a pretty hard guy to arouse. But when something makes sense, I'm for it.
Makes sense? Supporting schools to increase our educational standards makes dollars and cents. Why, a real estate man can't show you a house without saying, we have good schools in the neighborhood.
A good school is like a community house, meeting place for PTA and the Boy Scouts.
That is adult education. The doors are open to any worthwhile cause.
We all agree on that, even I. But what are we going to do about it?
Well, for one thing, we can check up on our local schools, see what's going on there, and find out what they require.
That's good. And your own neighborhood is the place to start.
I'm going to get behind the schools in my community and see to it that everyone I know realizes the importance of money invested in education. Yes, sir. I'm going to look out for my child.
Good. That's fine. And don't forget to look out for the other man's child.
In a free country, we elect our government officials. I'm going to support the school board I helped to elect.
That's right. Let them know you're behind them.
No one can work without tools. I'm all for giving the schools the best that can be had.
Mm-hmm. And help the schools give every American citizen the best that can be had.
I'm going to let our teachers know that we appreciate their part in raising our children. And I'm going to work with them because they need my help. I'm going to see that they get cooperation and benefits from a grateful community. The kind of gratitude that befits a noble profession.
Good. That'll help.
But I still don't know what...
It's going to take your time and your effort. And it'll take your vote as an American citizen. Are you up to it?
Yeah. I fought for freedom once. And now I'm going to work for it. I'm behind our schools from now on. And I'm backing education 100%. That's what I'm going to do. Now, what are you going to do?